Hi, my name is Jay Leeming, and I'm a performance storyteller from the Finger Lakes region of upstate New York. In this video, I'm going to talk about the sequoia trees of the Sierra Nevada of California. And I'm going to talk about them in relation to the story of Gilgamesh, the epic of Gilgamesh, which is about 4,000 years old. And yes, that's what I'm going to talk about. So why am I telling you about this? Well, these stories are from the past, but they happen right now. And they have happened, and in many ways they are circular, and we live inside these stories. And myself, I was lucky enough to be a ranger in Yosemite National Park for 5 summers. And there I got to spend some time with the sequoia trees. It was part of my job every week to go to a grove of sequoia trees, the Tuolumne Grove there, sometimes twice a week, and spend time with those trees and answer questions about them. That was a beautiful gift to have that opportunity, and it has deepened my sense of this story, and now hopefully yours as well, once I tell you about it a little bit. So I would go to this grove every week. I would hike down about a mile to a place down by a river there, and I would stand often near Big Red, which is the name humans have given to this ancient tree, about 3,000 years old, as far as we can tell, and about 240 feet high, I believe, something like that, and 23 feet thick. Now, these are a bunch of numbers, so contemplate that. A tree 23 feet in diameter. You could stop this video, you could walk 23 feet from your computer or your phone, and imagine what that is like. Look around you in your house. Are you in a room that's 23 feet wide? Probably not. Maybe you are, but conceive of that 23 feet in diameter, 3,000 years old, a tree that sprouted in the ground, a long time ago. A lot has happened since then. The rise and fall of the Roman Empire, the decline and fall of the Mayan Empire in Central America, several world wars. This tree has seen all of these things. So I would be down there with this tree, and I would be amazed myself, and then I would hear visitors to the park come and see this tree and be blown away, basically, by the size and the height of this tree. Now, these are sequoias. They are not the redwoods. The redwoods live on the coast of California. The sequoias live up in the mountains, and they require fire, and they require snow to exist in this world. The fire opens their cones and lets the seeds out. The fire clears away the brush because they're pioneers. They like to have a clear ground there without anything else there so they can go down and be the pioneer tree and sprout in that ground as well. These trees and humans have coexisted for a long time. The trees themselves are about 150 million years old as a species. Whether they will survive into the future, we do not know. But they've been around a long time. The natives there, the Miwok tribe, as far as we know, did not interact too much with these trees. There are no spear points, no human remains found in the groves of sequoia trees in the Sierra Nevada. So that's very interesting. The descendants of the European Americans and their descendants have a different story of their relation to this tree, which is key to understanding this and relating it to Gilgamesh. Their first sort of sight of these trees by the European Americans, of course, not the Miwok, was in 1833. A group of explorers called the Walker Party were traveling through the Sierra Nevada mountains. And they were having a tough time. They were losing the light and the warmth. They were coming at the end of the season. Winter was coming in fast, as it does there at that elevation, about September. I've been there. I worked at 9,000 feet up. That's where I lived with my family. And autumn came quick at the end of August, and then pretty soon it feels like winter. So they were traveling across these mountains, and they were in a sorry state. They were starving. But they did stumble into the grove, the Tuolumne Grove, where I would often go, and they saw those trees. They survived that expedition. The Walker Party had 33 horses with them. They ate 24 of them by the time they were done. That's a grim number, and there's an intense story there. 33 horses, they ate 24 of them. They survived that trip, and someone wrote a book of that journey, However, and this book described the sequoias, these huge trees they'd found. But every copy of that book, save a few copies, two or three, was burned in a fire in the house where they were stored. So this story never got out into the world, the European-American world, through that expedition. Well, time passed. In 1849, something happened. Gold was discovered by the European-Americans in those mountains. And humans love gold. These particular humans love gold. The gold rush was a huge event. Thousands of people were suddenly in the mountains looking for gold. Now, when we think of a gold rush, often, for me and for my childhood upbringing, I think of a prospector with a pan in a stream. Certainly that did happen. But we also have to imagine, we have to conceive of the industrial energy of something like Exxon Mobil or British Petroleum, the energy which is alive in our world now. We have to translate that into the past, and that's the kind of energy we're talking about. It is one guy with a pan in a stream, but it is also just thousands of people working very hard and doing crazy things, like diverting rivers. They would divert a river, get it to go through a hillside, wash that hillside away, and then get all the gold from that hillside. This was a huge operation. These mountains had not seen anything like it ever before. And it was a huge disaster ecologically, of course. So that happened, 1849. 1852, there's a hunter by the name of Augustus T. Dowd. And he was a hunter. He was hired by some carpenters. Now, this will give you an example of the scale of this operation. There were miners there. The mining people had hired carpenters to build sluiceways to bring water from rivers to the mining camps so the miners could drink, because everybody needs to drink. So those carpenters then hired hunters to get them animals to eat, because everyone needs to eat. So that's, again, think of the scale here. Miners, and then we need carpenters to build a sluiceway to give us water for all these thousands of people. And then we need hunters to kill us animals so we can eat. So Augustus T. Dowd was one of these many hunters. And one day, he went off into the forest, and he shot a grizzly bear. Now, grizzlies have been extinct in California since 1922, I believe, the last one. There is a grizzly on the flag. But there are no grizzlies in California. Check that out. There's one on the flag. There is not a live grizzly in California. But at this time, there were grizzlies. Augustus T. Dowd went hunting. He shot that grizzly bear. He did not kill it, and it ran away from him, this wounded grizzly bear, crashing, I can only imagine, through the forest away from this maniac with a weapon. And where did the bear go? Why did the bear go where it went? Who knows? But the bear did go to a grove of sequoia trees. Augustus, following that bear, came to that grove and was astounded at what he saw. Gigantic trees. This was the Calaveras Grove. It's a little lower elevation than the one I knew in Yosemite. And he stumbled out into it and he saw these immense trees 2,000-3,000 years old, trees, again, 20 feet in diameter, towering up hundreds of feet up into the sky. He forgot about that bear and marveled at those trees and then returned to his hunting camp there with the carpenters, you would imagine, and actually with his hunting buddies there. And he told them about these trees, but they did not believe him. That is a continual refrain with Yosemite and many things in the physical natural world. You have to be there to believe it. He told all his hunting friends about these trees. They did not believe it. They could not conceive of trees this large. He was making it up, they were sure. In fact, he could not get them to go with him to see the trees. They wouldn't go. Forget it. You can only imagine what they would have said. Forget it, you're making it up. No way am I going to see these silly trees. Well, a week later, he made up a story about a huge grizzly he had killed, and he said he needed help calling it back to camp. So they could conceive of a large grizzly bear. They could not imagine. See how our imaginations limit our world and our sense of what is possible, and how to awaken our imaginations is perhaps the deepest work. So they could not conceive of a tree that large, but they could conceive of a bear that big. So they went with him, and they went to get this grizzly bear in the woods. and he led them, taking the same trail, of course. He must have had to do so. He followed the same trail that wounded grizzly had taken. He went to the Calaveras Grove, and he showed them the trees. They were astounded. We don't know exactly what happened. I like to think he said something like, "Guys, I lied about the bear." But in any case, they saw those trees, and after that, word began to spread, again, through the European-American community. There's a whole nother story here of the Miwok and the native indigenous inhabitants of the Sierra Nevada and their relation to the trees, a story which I don't know. There's a lot of reasons for that, of course. In any case, the European Americans found out about this, and an article got into a paper. Pretty soon, many people knew about the trees, and they came, and they tried to cut them down, and they succeeded. That was one of the first things that they did. Besides marveling at them, you would think, ah, we can use this tree. Amazing, a huge tree, that's a lot of wood, of course. It took 25 men 10 days to cut down the first sequoia tree. 25 men, hard, burly men, I can only imagine, who were used to cutting down trees, but it took them 10 days. They did not have saws large enough to cut into that tree. In the end, they had to use augers, these huge drills, to drill into the tree so they could get saw blades in there to work on that tree. Amazing. Eventually, they did topple a tree. They toppled many trees. And again, there was this feeling that you have to see it to believe it. So efforts were made to do this. They skinned a tree. They took all the bark off this huge tree, it's hundreds of feet high, and they sent it to New York City on a train, and then they got it to London, England, into the Crystal Palace there, where it was set up for a while so people could see this amazing tree. There was later a fire, and the Crystal Palace was destroyed, and the bark of that tree. And of course, the tree in the Sierra Nevada was killed as well, once you remove all its bark. They also took a slice of a sequoia tree, a gigantic slice. They shipped it on a train to New York City to show people the rings on this thing, the size of this tree. But people did not believe it. They called it the California hoax. Somehow they thought somebody had manufactured this item, this artifact there. So people did not believe, but still people came and they did cut these trees down. Now the thing about a sequoia tree is when it falls, it shatters. So you don't get a lot of usable big pieces of wood. A tree that's 20 feet in diameter, you can't get a board that's, say, 10 feet wide from it. Instead, you get little splinters, basically, that you can use for tent stakes and making fence posts and things like that. It's not a very glorious end for such a glorious tree, a tree that has seen so much. But that is the facts. So sequoias shatter when they fall, and there was some outcry as well. People said, oh, we should preserve these trees and keep them alive. But largely because they could not be used in such an effective way for carpentry and building things, they were more or less spared. 30% of the sequoias were logged and killed, and the rest were survived. Now, the coast redwood, also a huge tree, higher, in fact, than the sequoia, 200, 300 feet high, lives on the coast, needs the fog of those coasts. Now, that tree you can use for lumber much more effectively. 98% of the coast redwoods were logged. 30% of the sequoias were logged. See how our hunger drives what we do. See how our desires affect the world. 98% of the redwoods, which were usable for lumber, were cut. 30% of the sequoias were cut. So, I hope you see some parallels to stories. The Epic of Gilgamesh, also the Three Wishes, that is a story I've told, it's on my website as well, which deals with human hunger and the natural world. The sequoias survive today in a tenuous way, as so many things do now. They are in the mountains. Like I said, they need snow and they need fire. And they live in the Sierra Nevada. But with climate change, of course, everything is changing. And a sequoia can't move the way other species can. So who knows what will happen to those trees. I should say as well, they were endangered for a time as well because humans put out fires in the Sierra Nevada. Humans think, well, trees, fire, bad. But in fact, sequoias, as I said earlier, they need fire to survive. It clears away the brush down there. It opens their cones so they can fall down and flourish in the ground of that soil. So for many years, humans put out fires, which was a great danger. There were no sequoia sprouts because of that. Finally, in the 60s, in Kings Canyon National Park, they started letting fires burn, which is healthier for the forest out there and does make it so sequoias can sprout. Nowadays, folks try to do that as well in Yosemite. It's become very problematic, of course, because you want to save human structures and human life as well. But letting the fires burn is best for the sequoias. So I ask you to conceive of these trees in your imaginations, to hold that in your hearts. Norse mythology talks about a tree at the center of the world. I think of that when I think of the sequoias as well. A tree 3,000 years old. Think of all it has been through, what it is like. What is it like to be a tree rooted in the ground like that? Experiencing the world in that way for so long. What is time to a tree like that? What is a day for a sequoia? How is that different? Are we mayflies compared to them? Are we mosquitoes compared to them in our perception of time? It's a fantastic and beautiful thing to consider. And as I say, we hope they survive, but that's not guaranteed for the sequoias or for any of us. The Gilgamesh story wrestles with apocalypse in a very deep way. It questions civilization, the very project of civilization from the beginning. We've got a cruel king, and we've got Humbaba, the guardian of the forest, who was killed, spoiler alert, killed by Gilgamesh and Enkidu. And then they have trees for the city of Uruk, which was a desert city and needed lumber, of course. Trees came from far away for them. So that epic, that story, questions, wrestles with civilization itself. Should it survive? What is it like if it survives? What is the cost? Look around you. Is there wood around you in your house, in your pencils, in your house, in your furniture? Yes, I would guess there is. There is in my house. What is the cost of that? What is the price? And now as we move deep into the consequences of our actions, as we move deeper into the fiery riddle that is climate change and the disaster, the strange, frantic story that is, this story can instruct us, Gilgamesh can, and perhaps as well the story of the sequoias in the Sierra Nevada. Thank you for watching this video. If you're able to support exertions like this, please do so. There's information on my website about Patreon, how you can support me there. May we remember these trees. May we remember the old part of ourselves, which is rooted in this earth and knows what to do and dreams itself up into the sky. Take care and be well.